Hello everyone and welcome to the workshop. Today I'm going to compare the three main small factor SBCs available in the market right now to see which one I'm going to be using in future products. I'll be taking a look at the Raspberry Pi Zero 2W, the Radxa Zero 3W, and the Orange Pi Zero 2W. I'll try to keep them all straight since the names are so close together. To make it all a little bit more fun, I'll be grading these boards in three different categories. Ease of use, because I already have a tendency to start projects and never finish them, so a board that's easy to use will help me complete a project for once. Ease of use will also include a grade for OS availability, because having different OSs available can make or break a project. Then I'll take a look at documentation. I want to spend time working on my project and not hunting around for answers in a Discord server somewhere. The third category is performance. These things are computers after all, so we have to grade their performance. But the board with the most processing power might not be the perfect board if it lacks in other areas. A bonus category will be accessories, which is also very important if you're just trying to knock out a project. Using accessories can get you faster to the finish line. All of the boards I'll be comparing today have the same zero form factor. Raspberry Pi introduced this very popular form factor when they launched the Raspberry Pi Zero back in November of 2015. Although the Zero boards don't have the same I/O as a full-size SBC, they're very popular because of their minute size. Before we compare the boards in these three categories, let's take a look at their basic specs. First, we have the most recent iteration of the Raspberry Pi Zero board, the Zero 2W. It has a quad-core 64-bit ARM Cortex-A53 clocked at 1 GHz. It only has 520 MB of RAM. You heard that right, not even 1 GB of RAM. In fact, this is the board with the least amount of RAM I'll be comparing today. So it has a microSD card slot, 2.4 GHz wireless LAN, Bluetooth 4.2 and BLE with a built-in antenna, mini HDMI, micro USB ports for connectivity and power. It also has a CSI camera connector and the usual 40-pin GPIO. It measures 65mm by 30mm, which are the same dimensions for all of the boards we'll be comparing today, since they have the same form factor. The Raspberry Pi Zero 2W costs only $15, and it is the cheapest of the three boards. Moving on to the Radxa Zero 3W. This is the newest board from the three that we're comparing today, and also the one with the highest specs. But you know, a Lotus spec sheet doesn't necessarily translate to better performance or best ease of use. The Zero 3W has a Rockchip 3566 on board, which is a quad-core ARM Cortex-A55 CPU clocked at 1.6 GHz. Also has an ARM Mali G52-2EE GPU. It comes in four different RAM configurations with 1, 2, 4, and 8 GB of LPDDR4 RAM. The version I have here is the 2 GB. In addition to the microSD slot, it also has different versions with 8, 16, 32, and 64 GB of EEMC. This one is the 16 GB version. It has Wi-Fi 6, Bluetooth 5.4 and BLE with an onboard antenna and also the option for an external antenna. Micro HDMI capable of 1080p at 60 frames per second, USB-C for connectivity and power. Just like the Raspberry Pi, it has a CSI connector for a camera and of course the 40-pin GPIO. The prices for this one ranges from $16 to $49, depending on the amount of RAM and the EEMC. The version that I have here is the 2 GB of RAM and 16 GB of EEMC, and I bought it for $31. Finally, here are the specs for the Orange Pi Zero 2W. It has an all-winner H618 chip, which consists of ARM Cortex-A53 CPU clocked at 1.5 GHz, and it has integrated Mali G31 MP2 graphics. It also comes in four different RAM configurations with 1, 1.5, 2, and 4 GB of LPDDR4 RAM. MicroSD card slot and no option for EMC on this one. It has Wi-Fi 6, so 5 GHz, Bluetooth 5.0, and there is no mention of BLE in the specs, but I suspect it does have BLE capabilities. Mini HDMI capable 4K 60fps, so that's crazy for such a small board to be able to do 4K 60. It does not have a camera connector, and instead it has a 24-pin expansion connector where you can add Ethernet, additional USB ports, and buttons. They have this funky little expansion board available for sale, but I do not have this expansion board, so I will not be testing it. Pricing ranges from $20 for the 1GB RAM version all the way up to $32 for the 4GB version. The version I have is the 1.5GB and I paid $24 for it. One thing that is interesting about this board is that it is available on Amazon US and you can get it with free Prime shipping if you subscribe to Prime, of course, which might make it cheaper than the other boards if you consider shipping. Links below. So let's take a look at the very first grading category in my very scientific grading methodology, ease of use. In this category, I'll be taking a look at how easy it is to get the board up and running, the available documentation, and how compatible it is with other hardware. Let's start with the creators of the Zero SBC form factor, Raspberry Pi. Getting the Pi Zero 2W set up was a breeze. I fired up Raspberry Pi Imager, selected the Pi Zero 2 as my board. I was a little bit surprised to only see the legacy versions of Raspberry Pi OS, which is based on Debian Bullseye. I was expecting to see Bookworm available, and not even the Lite version for the Zero 2W is available on Bookworm. Other than this minor hiccup, setting up my user, remote SSH access, and Wi-Fi credentials was super simple with Raspberry Pi Imager. This makes it for a great user experience, especially when setting up a board headless, meaning without the use of a monitor, keyboard, and a mouse attached to the Zero 2W. This couldn't have been easier, so I'm giving the Raspberry Pi 2W 10 points. Well, let's check out their online documentation. And spoiler alert, Raspberry Pi has the best documentation out there. Documentation is thorough, accurate, and easy to understand, even for someone just getting started in the SBC world. I mean, take a look at this section on how to use their camera modules and the Pi camera software. This is just beautiful. It has hardware information in great detail, software information with good examples, and how to get started. This is exactly what I needed. So I'm awarding them another 10 points for their thoughtful documentation. Great start for the Raspberry Pi Zero 2W with 20 points on the scoreboard. Let's see how the Orange Pi Zero 2W fares in this category. First thing I noticed when I landed on the Orange Pi's website is that they don't use encryption. All right, let's check the calendar real quick. Yep, we're in 2024, right? How is this still a thing? Finding the official OS images for the Zero 2W was easy enough, and they have a decent selection of available OSs. It looks like the Orange Pi OS is based on Arch Linux, and they also have a standard Android image, so that's really good. You know what's not cool though? The fact that you have to download the images from a Google Drive folder. At least the folders are organized and I was able to find the image that I wanted for my board. And hey, take a look, it's Bookworm, the newest version of Debian, so that deserves some credit. There is also a third-party image that is Raspberry Pi OS? This is just someone making Raspberry Pi OS available for Orange Pi boards, and it's not one of their first-party images, so keep that in mind. And fun fact, you can use a Raspberry Pi Imager to flash any image to any SD card, even if it's not for a Raspberry Pi board. So that's what I used to get started on my Orange Pi Zero 2W. I just selected Use Custom and chose the downloaded image. After flashing the image, I wanted to check in the documentation how to set it up headless. The user manual is a 331-page PDF, which is kind of a pain to navigate around and use the search function. It's clunky, but it's fine. I was able to find the information that I was looking for, like the default password. Setup though wasn't as straightforward as the Raspberry Pi. I was not able to change the username and the password before the first boot, and there is no way to configure Wi-Fi credentials without the use of a monitor and a keyboard. So the Orange Pi Zero 2W is definitely losing some points here. I noticed the documentation has these weird callouts, like this one saying, if you can't log in using the default password, you shouldn't suspect that it has a different password. Okay. I'm awarding them 8 points for ease of use. I had to subtract a couple points here and there for Google Drive situation and not being able to change login and Wi-Fi credentials without a monitor and a keyboard. I'll give them extra point for OS availability though. I think that's fair. Documentation deserves a 7 because it's a little bit better than just average. So tally it up, 16 points for Orange Pie. Not bad. Moving on to the Radxa Zero 3W. There are only 2 OS options available, Debian and Ubuntu, so that's a little bit skimpy. This is odd because on the product page they advertise extensive open source OS support, but that doesn't seem to be the case for the Zero 3W. This is a fairly new board though, so hopefully there will be more options available in the future. I first thought they were going to get low marks in this category, but after flashing the SD card, I was pleasantly surprised to see options to change the default login information and the Wi-Fi credentials before the first boot. After flashing the OS, there is this first boot configuration file on a partition that's accessible even on Windows, so that's really cool. So installing a new OS and getting the board up and running was pretty easy. I'll give them 9 points for ease of use. Keep in mind though that flashing an image to the onboard EEMC is not as easy as the SD card. It involves installing a driver, downloading a proprietary flasher utility, a bootloader file, and pressing a physical button on the board while you connect it to your computer. To be fair though, this is the case for most SBCs that have an onboard EEMC. Even the Raspberry Pi CM4 works in a similar fashion, so I won't ding them for that. 9 points it is. If you buy the EEMC version, you should know this going in. I will take 1 point away for OS availability. 2 OSs is the bare minimum. Raspberry Pi and Orange Pi have more options, so sorry Radxa. So let's take a look at their documentation. And documentation is pretty bad. Like, what is this? Application, development, wiring X? Oh, that's cool. That sounds like a Radxa version of the wiring Pi. Oh, okay. I guess that's not cool. Just a blank page? Sensors. I love sensors. Let's take a look at some examples. Oh, wow. Okay. Let's try to find some better examples. Okay. This is not great. I guess this is better than nothing, but there are no explanations or background information. It looks like a bunch of snippets that were just copied and pasted from somewhere else. Definitely not friendly for a beginner. So it's getting 4 for worse than mediocre documentation. Not a good start for the Radxa, getting only 13 points in the first round. Can it recover though? Alright, let's take a look at performance. This will be pretty simple. I'm going to run a CPU benchmark and assign 10 points to the best performing board. All the other boards will get a percentage based on their benchmarking score. I hope that makes sense. The Radxa Zero 3W edged out in this test and takes the top step with 537 on the CPU benchmark. Good job, Radxa. You earned the 10 points on this one, fair and square. Maybe they can recover from the initial low score. We'll find out. Orange Pi takes the second place with a score of 504. This is only 6% worse than the Radxa board. I'm rounding things up a little bit just to make it easier, and I'm giving Orange Pi 9 points for performance. The Raspberry Pi lagged quite a bit behind on this one, getting a score of 361. That's only 2/3 of the performance of the Radxa Zero 3W. So that means the Raspberry Pi is only getting 6 points for performance. I know that most people are not going to be using this board as a desktop computer, but I feel like I have to bring this up. The desktop experience on the Orange Pi Zero 2W running Debian is much better than the other two boards. There is no lag using the menus or moving screens around, and it has a good browser experience. It's really cool to see a board this small that can be used as a desktop computer. Again, most people are not going to use it this way, but I think it was worth mentioning. The experience on the Radxa is not as good as the Orange Pi with some visible lag. You can see it just scrolling through the menus and it feels sluggish overall, which is kind of expected on a board like this one, so it's still pretty good. desktop usage on the Raspberry Pi is very okay-ish. Well, that is until you open a web browser. Chrome U on the Raspberry Pi Zero 2W is flat out unusable. After waiting way too long, I just gave up and closed the browser. So I think the Orange Pi deserves an extra point for desktop usability. Let's take a look at the scoreboard. Raspberry Pi and Orange Pi are tied, and Radxa is lagging behind. The documentation is really holding back the Radxa board. If most people won't be using these boards as a desktop computer, what are the use cases for these tiny little boards? Since they're so small, they're perfect for embedded robotics projects, a field camera, or even handheld gaming devices. All of these boards are very capable of being the heart of a robot, but there is one big difference to call out. If you're building a robot with vision, the Orange Pi doesn't have a camera connector. Remember, this connector at the edge of the board of the Orange Pi is called a function interface, which is more like an expansion port, not a camera connector. Whereas both the Raspberry Pi and the Radxa boards have dedicated CSI connectors. This brings us to our bonus category, accessories. Although the Radxa has a camera connector, it is not compatible with the same number of cameras as the Raspberry Pi. Looking through the device tree overlays, we can see that it only has support for the V1 and the V2 Raspberry Pi camera modules. Raspberry Pi Zero 2W is compatible with the older V1 and V2 camera modules, just like the Radxa, but also the newer camera modules, like the V3 that has autofocus and the high-quality camera module. It's also compatible with a wide range of third-party camera modules like the RDCam. I was trying to figure out if there are drivers for the RDCam cameras for the Radxa board, but I can't find anything in the documentation, so I'm just going to assume the RDCam does not support Radxa boards. Sticking with the camera theme, Raspberry Pi has a nice Python library called PiCamera2 that you can use to control their camera modules. This is pretty awesome and allows people to create things like this web UI that makes it super easy to tweak camera settings and capture images. I have links for this web UI down below. Radxa only offers GStreamer bindings to capture picture or videos from the camera modules, and it requires more complicated commands like the one you see on the screen right now. The Raspberry Pi solution is definitely more polished. So I think this is where I landed on the score for this category. Raspberry Pi gets 10 points for supporting a wide range of camera modules and having a healthy ecosystem with tons of accessories available from third party and the community. Both Orange Pi and Radxa advertise their boards as having a 40-pin header that is compatible with SBC accessories. But this is a little bit misleading. Although the different functional pins like SPI, UART, and I2C are almost in the same place as the Raspberry Pi, it doesn't mean that available software for a particular accessory that you're looking for will work on the Orange Pi or the Radxa boards. With all that being said, Radxa Zero 3W gets 7 points for having limited camera support and limited GPIO accessory support. Since the Orange Pi doesn't have support for camera modules and it has the same issue with GPIO accessory support, it is only getting 5 points. I know, it's harsh, but it is what it is. So there you have it. According to my very scientific grading system, the Raspberry Pi scored the highest. But is it the best for your project? It really depends on what you want to get out of these boards. Do you need all the CPU performance you can get in a small package? Then the Radxa board is probably the best option. If you want to run Android, well, the Orange Pi is the best option because it is available as a first-party image. If you're looking for the best support and ease of use, nothing beats the Raspberry Pi, in my opinion. I think some people are going to be mad about this comment, so if you're one of those people, let me know in the comments. I think this is it for this one. If you have made it this far in the video, thank you. I really appreciate it. If you leave a comment, make sure to use the word delighted. That way I'll know that you're one of the people that watch until the end. Also, feel free to let me know what kind of projects you're working on and what kind of SBC content you would like to see on the channel. So, I'll see you in the next one.